Hi friends, this is the fifth lecture of discussion on module 3 of engineering physics 18 PHY 12 bar 22. Myself Dr. Mahesh Lohit KS, associate professor and head department of physics ATME College of Engineering Mysuru, here to discuss the following contents. The topics of today's discussion are Gauss flux theorem of electrostatics, Gauss divergence theorem, Stokes theorem, Gauss law of magnetism and Ampere's law. These are the theorems and laws which are required for the formulation of the Maxwell's equations. The first theorem that we need to discuss is Gauss flux theorem. This is the Gauss flux theorem of electrostatics. The statement of this theorem is the total electric flux exiting any volume is equal to the total charge enclosed by the volume. Mathematically, it is represented by this integral, that is integral over a closed surface d vector d dot vector ds, that is equal to q enclosed, that is the total charge enclosed by the Gaussian surface or the closed surface. Let us understand this particular theorem through this diagram. We have a closed surface here, and this closed surface encloses volume V. Let us say this closed surface is S, and it encloses charge Q. So, this Q could be written as this Q is nothing but the total charge enclosed. This is nothing but Q 1 plus Q 2 plus Q 3 plus etcetera. These charges Q 1, Q 2 are distributed inside this volume, and these charges may be positive or negative, and using this we calculate the total charge, that is nothing but Q. This is the charge Q enclosed by the volume, or enclosed by the closed surface. Now, according to Gauss theorem, that is Gauss flux theorem, let us consider a small area, elemental area on the Gaussian surface. This closed surface which encloses charge is called as a Gaussian surface, and this is the area vector corresponding to this elementary area. There are diverging flux lines as the the surface encloses charges, and flux lines are exiting, they are coming out of this volume, or they are emanating through the surface, emanating through the closed surface. Now, the total flux emanating through this surface is given by the integral of the flux through each and every elementary surface. So, the flux through a smaller surface, that is this elementary surface, is given by d dot ds, the dot product of the area vector of this small elementary area and the electric flux density vector there. And this has to be calculated throughout the Gaussian surface. So, we assume that this Gaussian surface is made of many such small elements. So, therefore, the integral over a surface, closed surface, vector d dot vector ds is equal to the the total charge enclosed by the Gaussian surface. This is the meaning. So, what is the physical significance of this? The physical significance of this law is the charges act as either source or sink. For example, if there's a net flux coming out of the Gaussian surface, means this volume enclosed by the surface has charges which act as sources, and if the flux lines or the net flux is into this volume, it means the charges act as sinks. So, this is the physical significance of Gauss flux theorem. The next topic of discussion is the Gauss divergence theorem. So, we shall state the Gauss divergence theorem, we shall know its mathematical representation. After that, we will prove the Gauss divergence theorem, and finally, we shall also have the intuition of this Gauss divergence theorem. To start with, let us consider a closed surface which encloses charges, and charges are distributed throughout the volume enclosed by the surface, and this surface is called Gaussian surface. So, charges are distributed all over the volume enclosed by this Gaussian surface. Inside this volume, consider a point, and around that point consider a small elementary volume dV, and let dQ be the charge enclosed by this small elementary volume dV, and rho V is the density of charges at this particular point. And this is the Gaussian surface. Okay. So, since we are representing it on two dimension, it appears like a line. No, it is a closed surface. We are speaking about the Gaussian surface. The statement of Gauss divergence theorem, it states that the surface integral of normal component of the electric flux density over a Gaussian surface is equal to the volume integral of divergence of the flux throughout the volume enclosed by the Gaussian surface. So, this is the statement. So, we can analyze it in two parts. The surface integral of the normal component of the flux density over a Gaussian surface. So, if we consider a small volume, a small surface area here, area vector is ds, let us say the flux density is d, then this d dot ds gives the small flux through this elementary area, then if we carry out integration, it will give the total flux emanating through this through this Gaussian surface, and it is given by integral over a closed surface vector d dot vector ds. This is one part. The second part is equal to the volume integral of the divergence of the flux throughout the space enclosed by the Gaussian surface. So, now if you consider that this volume has many such elementary volumes, in each volume there is divergence of flux density, and if you take the sum of that, means if you integrate, you will get the integral of divergence of d over volume v, and these two are same. I will explain more about the intuition in the last stage of discussion of this particular topic. Now, let us prove this Gauss divergence theorem. To start with, we have this equation, the divergence of d is equal to rho v, that is charge density at that point. You consider a small volume here, the divergence of flux density means whether this point is a source or sink, it depends on this charge density. Okay. So, divergence of d, that is electric flux density, is rho v, and this is also called as the first Maxwell's equation. So, based on this, we shall prove the Gauss divergence theorem. So, as per the diagram, there is a small volume dV which encloses charge dQ Therefore, the density of charge in that small elementary volume rho v is given by dq by dv, and this implies that the charge dq enclosed by a small elementary volume is given by rho v dv. Okay. The total charge is enclosed by the Gaussian surface is given by, so means this is q, dq is the charge enclosed by a small elementary volume inside the volume enclosed by the Gaussian surface. Then what is the total charge? So we assume that this particular volume enclosed by the Gaussian surface made up of large number of small elementary volumes, okay, and we calculate the charge in each of these. So let me show that to you here. See, like this, there is one more elementary area here, volume here, there is one more elementary volume, there is one more volume here, there is one more volume, like this. This is made up of large number of elementary volumes, and charge in each elementary volume is dq. Okay. Then if we add everything, we will get the total charge enclosed by the Gaussian surface. So therefore, this total charge q is given by integral over a volume dq. This dq is the charge enclosed by a small elementary volume. This gives the total charge. So we know that dq is equal to rho v dv, and we get this expression. Okay. Now we shall substitute for rho v in terms of the equation. What is that equation? This divergence of d is equal to rho v. So d is the electric flux density. So if we substitute, we get q is equal to this. Okay, del dot d, over a integral over a volume dv. This is nothing but the total charge. According to the Gauss flux theorem, the total charge enclosed by the Gaussian surface is given by this equation. This is as per Gauss flux theorem. Okay. The total flux emanating from a Gaussian surface is equal to the charge, is proportional to the charge enclosed by the Gaussian surface, that is q. So equating these two equations, we get q is equal to, we have q is equal to integral surface d dot ds, and previously we have the same q is equal to integral over volume divergence of d. So we can equate these two. So here we have thus the Gauss divergence theorem. So this Gauss divergence theorem relates a surface integral with a volume integral. What is the intuition of this Gauss divergence theorem? The intuition of this Gauss divergence theorem is, you can see that this a volume enclosed by a Gaussian surface, so this is a Gaussian surface, and this Gaussian surface is enclosed by a volume, and the flux lines are coming out. The total flux emanating from this Gaussian surface is given by integral over a surface d dot ds. This is the left hand side. So that is the total flux coming out of this Gaussian surface, emanating from the Gaussian surface. Now we have a large number of small elementary volumes here inside this larger volume. This larger volume is V and this small volume is dV, as we considered earlier. Now, if we consider this point here, if the flux lines diverge, then divergence is positive, okay? Otherwise, the divergence is negative. Means this point, whether it is a source or sink, depends on the divergence value. So when we add these two, when we add a positive divergence with a positive divergence, they get added. And when we add a positive divergence with a negative divergence value, then there will be subtraction. Means if we have a negative divergence here, this becomes a sink and this becomes a source, and flux lines may move from source to sink. So therefore, the net flux coming out of me out of this decreases. So therefore, the divergence of each and every smaller elementary volume here contributes to the total flux. Therefore, we take the integral of this divergences over a volume, and that is equal to the total flux emanating from the Gaussian surface. Therefore, this is the intuition of this Gaussian surface. So, finally, to remember this, we can remember it this way: integral over a volume, divergences of flux means at in each and every volume, smaller volume, we calculate the divergence, we integrate it over a volume, that is equal to the total flux emanating from the surface. This is the intuition of Gauss divergence theorem. We shall discuss one more important theorem, which is very much essential for the formulation of Maxwell's equations, which is nothing but Stokes' theorem. We shall state the Stokes' theorem, we shall have the mathematical form, and also let us have the intuition of this Stokes' theorem. Before we state the Stokes' theorem, consider this diagram. So, there is a vector field here. This vector field is denoted by a vector function f. Inside this vector field, we consider a closed loop or closed path as shown here, and this closed path encloses a surface, okay, and this is called as a chosen surface, and the boundary of this chosen surface is nothing but the closed path. So, based on this, we shall have the statement, we shall state the Stokes' theorem. The Stokes' theorem states that the surface integral of curl of f throughout the chosen surface is equal to the circulation of f around the boundary of the chosen surface. Let me put it here again. See, this is the surface enclosed by the closed path, and this is the chosen surface S, which is enclosed by the closed path. And the curl of f, here we consider curl of f throughout this surface. For that, we consider this surface to be made up of large number of small elementary surfaces. Okay. So, the surface integral of curl in each elementary surface is given by this equation, this part of the equation, that is LHS, is equal to the circulation of f around the boundary, or the circulation following the flow following the boundary of this particular chosen surface, that is given by the RHS. So, this is the statement and the mathematical form of Stokes' theorem. The syllabus. So, therefore, I move on to the intuition of this Stokes' theorem. The Stokes' theorem, it has two parts: the LHS, that is curl of f over a surface, and this surface is not a closed surface, you can see it is an open surface because it is enclosed by a boundary, it is not a closed surface, over a ds, this is equal to, right, the line integral or a closed path f dot dl. What is the meaning of this? Now, what we do? We consider that this complete surface of area S is divided into large number of small elementary surfaces ds, like this. Okay. So, what we do? We calculate the curl in each and every surface, smaller surface. Okay. So, this is the area and curl. So, we integrate with respect to ds, means we integrate the curls of all elementary areas. Okay. So, curl here plus curl here plus curl here plus curl here, here and all. So, if we have positive and negative curls, they get cancelled. Okay. So, finally, the flow, what is circulation, what is curl? Curl is nothing but some sort of rotation, it indicates some sort of rotation, right. So, swirling. So, the total swirling, okay, that is calculated is along the boundary of this surface, that is given by f dot dl over a closed path. So, this flow along the boundary is equal to the integral of curls throughout the surface. So, this is the intuition. So, we can write it in the form of a simple equation. The flux of curls, what do we mean by flux of curls? So, this is a curl, this is a curl, this is a curl, and when you put a total, it is the flux of curl, number of curls throughout a surface, chosen surface. So, that is the flux of curls, that is equal to flow following along the boundary. This is equal to the flow following along the boundary. If there are more curls here, then the flow, you know, along the boundary is equal to the integral of curls. This is the intuition of Stokes' theorem. Now, let us understand one more important theorem, and is called Gauss' law of magnetism. We have studied Gauss' law of electrostatics. Gauss' law of electrostatics states that charges they behave like either sinks or sources. The total flux emanating from the Gaussian surface is equal to the total charge enclosed by it. Let us study the same in case of magnetism. So, here we have a magnet, this is the north pole of a magnet and this is the south pole of a magnet, and these are the field lines. You can see here the field lines are continuous. See, in case of electric charges, so if there is a positive charge, field lines originate, okay. In case of negative charge, field lines terminate. So, source and sink, so isolated charges exist. So, separate source and sink, both they exist. Now, in this magnetic field set up by this bar magnet, we consider a Gaussian surface, say a sphere. It is shown as a circle here because it is two dimensional sketch. So, it is a sphere. Now, in the sphere, the number of field lines that are entering, the same number of field lines they are leaving, right. Whatever the field line enters, wherever you consider, even if you consider the Gaussian surface here inside, the number of field lines that enter, the same number of field lines they exit, means here there is no source or sink. There are neither sources nor sinks, but the lines exist as a closed path. Therefore, the divergence of the magnetic flux density has to be 0, because there are no source or sinks, there is no divergence here. So, therefore, the divergence of B is equal to 0, and this is the second Maxwell's equation. Okay. And in other words, if you consider this Gaussian surface, the total flux emanating out of this Gaussian surface is 0, because flux that enter, if you consider them as negative, and the flux that leave, if you consider them as positive, then the total will be 0. Therefore, integral over B dot ds is equal to 0. From Gauss divergence theorem, we can write this integral over a closed surface B dot ds is equal to the divergence of B, integral of divergence of B over a volume V. Therefore, since this is 0, del dot B has to be 0, that is divergence has to be 0. What does it mean? See, isolated electric charges or electric monopoles exist, which is the significance of the Gauss flux theorem of electrostatics. But as per the Gauss law of magnetism, magnetic monopoles do not exist, means we do not have isolated south pole and isolated north pole. Always they exist in terms of pairs, that is north and south poles. So, this is the physical significance of the Gauss law of magnetism. This is the last topic of today's discussion, that is Ampere's law. And it is one of the important law. And later Maxwell provides a correction for this, because this Ampere's law has some inconsistencies. So, to correct those inconsistencies, Maxwell introduces a correction which we will study in the future classes. This is the statement of Ampere's law. The Ampere's law states that the circulation of magnetic field strength H along a closed path is equal to the net current enclosed by the loop. This is the statement. You know, circulation is a line integral. Therefore, the line integral of H dot dl, H is the magnetic field strength and dl is a infinitesimally small length, the circulation along a closed path is equal to the net current enclosed by the path. And we shall understand this through a diagram soon. By applying Stokes' theorem, according to Stokes' theorem, the line integral could be converted into surface integral. So, you know the Stokes' theorem. So, the line integral, that is H dot dl, is converted into curl of H throughout the surface. So, that is del cross H over ds. This is equal to the total current enclosed, and it could also be written as integral over a surface J dot ds. Here J is the current density and ds is a small elementary area. I will explain this, what is this J dot ds. For example, let us say we consider we have a conductor here, this is the conductor, okay, and current is flowing this through this, current is I, and this conductor has a particular sectional area, and this area let us call it as A. We define a quantity, how dense the current is, it is a vector quantity, it is denoted by J is equal to I by A, this is called current density, current per unit cross sectional area. This equation holds good only when the current throughout is uniform, but we know that in case of a conductor, if I write the sectional view of the conductor, this is the cross section, it is circular. So, the current always flows on the outer layer, so you know the skin effect, and the density of the current goes on decreasing as you move towards the center or the axis of this conductor, means the current density is not constant, okay. So, therefore, when we express current, we consider that this sectional area is made up of a large number of small elementary areas, then the total current enclosed by this is equal to integral of this J dot ds. Why we consider the dot product? It is because of the reason this area may be oriented in some angle. If it is perpendicular, the maximum, you know, current flow will be maximum. If the orientation is horizontal, the current flow will be minimum. So, therefore, the orientation of this surface is also very, very important. Therefore, I enclosed could be written as integral over a surface J dot ds. So, therefore, I enclosed is integral over a surface J dot ds. Here, this vector J is called current density, okay. Let us understand the physical significance of Ampere's law. According to Ampere's law, integral over a closed path or a closed loop H dot dl is equal to the total current enclosed. Let us consider the currents here. Let us say they are I1, I2, I3, etcetera. If there is a current in the opposite direction, now it could be considered as negative, let us say I4. We consider an Amperean loop, a closed loop. So, this is the closed loop enclosing all these currents, and let us call this as an Amperean loop, and it is denoted by C. This loop is called the Amperean loop, and this Amperean loop encloses a surface. This Amperean loop encloses a surface, and the boundary of this surface is nothing but the Amperean loop. According to this Ampere's law, if we consider this loop to be made up of in a large number of infinitesimally small elements, then for each element if we calculate the product of H dot dl and then we integrate all along the loop, throughout the loop, then integral over a closed path H dot dl is equal to the total current enclosed. This total current is I1 plus I2 plus I3 minus I4. This is the meaning of Ampere's law. This is the physical significance. This could also be understood in another way. As per the equation number 8, this del cross H, that is curl of H, is equal to J, because this, if we compare this LHS with RHS, we get del cross H, that is curl of H, as current density. And also this B, magnetic flux density, is mu naught H, and hence we can write this H as B by mu naught. If we substitute for this H, we get the second equation, that is curl of magnetic flux density is mu naught J. What is the meaning of this? More the current density through this area enclosed by the loop, more will be the curl of the magnetic field strength or magnetic flux density. This is the meaning. Okay? Curl of H is equal to the current density that is flowing through the area of the loop. Now, we shall have the summary of today's discussion. Gauss flux theorem. Gauss flux theorem gives you the total flux emanating from a Gaussian surface, and it is equal to the total charge enclosed by it. It will give you the, you know, the nature of the so charges, that is whether it acts as a source or sink. Then Gauss divergence theorem. Gauss divergence theorem, the intuition of Gauss divergence theorem is the total flux that is emanating across through a Gaussian surface is equal to the volume integral of divergences at all points inside the Gaussian surface. Then we discussed about the Stokes theorem. The Stokes theorem states that the flux of curls, the flux of curls enclosed by a closed loop is equal to the circulation of flow of that particular vector field along the boundary of that closed surface or chosen surface, that is Stokes theorem. Then Gauss law of magnetism states that the magnetic monopoles do not exist. It means there are no sinks and sources in case of magnetism or magnetic poles. Then we studied Ampere's law. The Ampere's law states that stronger the current density or more the current, currents through a surface, then stronger will be the swirling of the magnetic field. So, in other words, if the current density is high, then the curl of the field will also be high, or the curling of the field will also be high. So, with this, we have come to the end of the session. Let us have two multiple choice questions. The first one is Gauss divergence theorem relates. So, please choose your answer. Please pick your answer. Yes. See, Gauss divergence theorem relates. It relates the surface integral with a volume integral. So, on left side, we have the surface integral to calculate the flux. On the right hand side, we have the volume integral of divergences. So, therefore, the option is 1. 1 is the correct answer. The second question is, MCQ is, the intuition of Stokes theorem. So, what is the intuition? The intuition of Stokes theorem is the total flux of curls, or the flux of curls, is equal to the circulation following the boundary. So, therefore, the total flux of curls is equal to circulation flow around the boundary of the surface is the correct option. Therefore, option 2 is the correct answer. See, the answers are little bit confusing here. The first two you can eliminate, because you can consider that Stokes theorem relates a line integral with a surface integral. So, therefore, volume integral never exists there. So, therefore, you can discard this volume things here. Okay, whatever the volume is there. So, the option is between 2 and 4, but here the total flux curls in circulation, but here total flux emanating from the closed surface. So, there may be a confusion, but you follow the Stokes theorem, it says circulation flow around the boundary of the surface. Therefore, the option is 2, correct option is 2. So with this, we have come to the end of the lecture, today's lecture. So I will close the session with a quote by Michael Faraday. Nothing is too wonderful to be true if it be consistent with the laws of nature. See, it need not be too wonderful, but if it is consistent with nature, that itself is beautiful, it's wonderful. Okay. So with this, I close the session. Thank you very much for patience listening. Have a great day.